Hetty understood this appeal, and she promised the Delaware girl not to make any allusion to the presence of Chingachgook, or to the motive of his visit to the lake.
"Maybe he get off Hurry and Fodder, as well as Hist, if let him have his way," whispered Wah-ta-Wah to her companion, in a confiding, flattering way, just as they got near enough to the encampment to hear the voices of several of their own sex, who were apparently occupied in the usual toils of women of their class.
"Think of dat, Hetty, and put 2 20 finger on mouth. No get friend free without serpent do it."
A better expedient could not have been adopted to secure the silence and discretion of Hetty than that which was now presented to her mind. As the liberation of her father and the young frontier man was the great object of her adventure, she felt the connection between it and the services of the Delaware, and with an innocent laugh she nodded her head, and in the same suppressed manner promised a due attention to the wishes of her friend. Thus assured, Hist tarried no longer, but immediately and openly led the way into the encampment of her captors. Chapter 11. The great King of Kings hath in the table of his law commanded that thou shalt do no murder. Take heed, for he holds vengeance in his hand to hurl upon their heads that break his law. Richard III, Act 1, Scene 4, lines 195 to 197 and 199 to 200. That the party to which Hist compulsorily belonged was not one that was regularly on the warpath was evident by the presence of females. It was a small fragment of a tribe that had been hunting and fishing within the English limits, where it was found by the commencement of hostilities, and after passing the winter and spring by living on what was strictly the property of its enemies, it chose to strike a hostile blow before it finally retired. There was also deep Indian sagacity in the maneuver which had led them so far into the territory of their foes. When the runner arrived who announced the breaking out of hostilities between the English and French, a struggle that was certain to carry with it all the tribes that dwelt within the influence of the respective belligerents, this particular party of the Iroquois were posted on the shores of the Oneida, a lake that lies some 50 miles nearer to their own frontier than that which is the scene of our tale. To have fled in a direct line for the Canadas would have exposed them to the dangers of a direct pursuit, and the chiefs had determined to adopt the expedient of penetrating deeper into a region that had now become dangerous, in the hope of being able to retire in the rear of their pursuers, instead of having them on their trail. The presence of the women had induced the attempt at this ruse, the strength of these feebler members of the party being unequal to the effort of escaping from the pursuit of warriors. When the reader remembers the vast extent of the American wilderness at that early day, he will perceive that it was possible for even a tribe to remain months undiscovered in particular portions of it, nor was the danger of encountering a foe, the usual precautions being observed, as great in the woods as it is on the high seas in a time of active warfare. The encampment being temporary, it offered to the eye no more than the rude protection of a bivouac, relieved in some slight degree by the ingenious expedients which suggested themselves to the readiness of those who passed their lives amid similar scenes. One fire that had been kindled against the roots of a living oak sufficed for the whole party, the weather being too mild to require it for any purpose but cooking. Scattered around this center of attraction were some 15 or 20 low huts, or perhaps kennels would be a better word, into which their different owners crept at night, and which were also intended to meet the exigencies of a storm. These little huts were made of the branches of trees, put together with some ingenuity, and they were uniformly topped with bark that had been stripped from fallen trees, of which every virgin forest possesses hundreds, in all stages of decay. Of furniture they had next to none. Cooking utensils of the simplest sort were lying near the fire. A few articles of clothing were to be seen in or around the huts. Rifles, horns, and pouches leaned against the trees, or were suspended from the lower branches, and the carcasses of 2 or 3 deer were stretched to view on the same natural shambles. As the encampment was in the midst of a dense wood, The eye could not take in its tout ensemble at a glance, but hut after hut started out of the gloomy picture as one gazed about him in quest of objects.